part of our initial session, we were able to look through on how do we get started with articles for the best solutions, right? So when we talk about the cloud, so we do not have any upfront investments. We can just get started with infrastructure, and then we have better utilization of the resources, as well as we are making the resources usage only on basis of the costing. And then when it comes to time to market, we are able to make it much faster when compared to the traditional way of doing the business in the software. And other few of the benefits also we have discussed, like everything can be automated in the help of scripting. We have something like auto scaling and proactive scaling, which helps us to ensure that whenever there is a demand which is going to be on my infrastructure, automatically the cloud is helping me to scale the systems up and down. And we have the more efficient development lifecycle when compared to the normal one in the traditional infrastructure. And we can also have the plans for the disaster recovery and the business continuity. And even though there is a lot of overflow of the traffic on the cloud, we'll be able to compare through. And we understood this specific diagram of elasticity, where I'm trying to involve the cost, where I'm trying to involve the infrastructure cost, and then the time, right? So in the traditional method, if you have seen this blue color dotted line, the blue and the gray colored are almost both of them are the little or same one for the traditional infrastructure, where we are trying to spend in lot of money at the initial level, and then we are trying to develop the solutions, and then again adding up the money, and then again adding up the infrastructure and other things, right? So this is like a step methodology, or we call this a waterfall methodology, where we are trying to go through step by step. But in case of cloud, we can start with a minimum of zero, and then we can always close off the things which are not required at any point in time. So with cloud, we have a lot of elasticity to go with. Next. Now, whenever you're going to be designing any kind of solution in the cloud, so in the future, whenever you're designing any kind of solution which is to be required on the cloud, always try to be a pessimist, right? So what happens by being pessimist? We try to think negative. What will happen if my server goes down? What will happen if the availability, zone goes down? What happens if the complete region itself goes down? Right, so we should always start thinking in a negative way on what can go wrong if I'm trying to deploy a solution on the cloud. And in this way, we will try to design and implement the solution in such a way that it will be always designed for any kind of recovery from the failure. So being a pessimist when designing the architecture in the cloud and assume that things will always fail. In other words, always design, implement and deploy automated recovery from the failure. So always think about the options where you can actually fail off while deploying the solutions in the cloud. So in that way, we'll always look for the alternative solution which is required to give us the automated recovery. So let's say in a particular situation, I assume that my hardware is going to fail. Let's say inside the AWS itself data center, there is a chance. We never know, like hardware itself fails, right? It does happen when we are working on a computer, suddenly we get a blue screen error. Right, so our computer gives off its way, right? So we never know what can happen at any point in time. So we should assume all the kinds of the scenarios. Where we can think about all the failures, right? Assume that the outages will occur. Assume that some disaster will strike your application. What if tomorrow Amazon comes up and says that we are going to have a maintenance period in the weekends, right? How are we going to manage it, right? So we should always think about all the kinds of failures. Assuming a disaster is going to strike my application, assume that it will be slammed with more than the number of requests per second. So currently we are assuming that we are going to have 100 requests per second, but let's say tomorrow you become much more popular and on your website you are expecting surge of users. So from 100 users, you are going to get, let's say, 1,000 users per second. Then how are we going to manage that? So assume that your time, assume with the time your application software will also fail, right? So we always have the software upgrades coming up, right? So initially when we started, I guess the Java was usually at very lower version, right? Today we are using some Java 1.8 or some versions, right? So versions of the software also keep changing. So assume that your software will also fail. So by being pessimist, you are trying to think about all the kind of recovery strategies that are actually required to design the overall system to be a better one. Next important point is whenever you are going to architect a solution, remember you have to always decouple your components. Right? What does the decoupling mean? Now, specifically, we are trying to remove of the dependencies between each of the layers. Okay, so if you have an application layer, if you have a database layer, if you have a web layer, you can actually remove the dependencies between each of them and then design it. Right? The key is to build the components that do not have tight dependencies on each other, so that if one component were to die, fail, or sleep off or remain busy for some reason, the other components of the systems are built so as to continue the work as if no failure is happening. Right? So we are going to design this system in such a way that we should ensure that we do not have any dependency of database on the web or the application layer. So even if they are down, we should be able to continue for our database to be working all the time, right? So we have to design in such a way that we can decouple your components. So specifically, whenever you think about decoupling the components, think about the SQS. That is one of the best component which helps us to decouple the solution in the architecture, right? So you can actually keep a SQS between the web and application layer, also SQS between the application and the database layer as well, right? So in essence, loose coupling isolates the various layers of the components of your application so that each component interacts asynchronously with each other and treats them as a black box. So it doesn't have a dependency on any of the backend, and it will treat that there's nothing as such called backend where I have to update the data. It will be treated as black box, but we are actually trying to send everything to the SQS, and from the SQS we are trying to send it to the database section. So here's one of the example. Let's say in case of web application architecture, you can isolate the application server from the web server and from the database, right? So as I said, usually what happens is in the real time, there are only two different types of architecture that we design. One is two-tier architecture and another is three-tier architecture. The example that is being shown up on your presentation screen here is a three-tier architecture where I have a web server, where I have an application server, and then I have a database server as well. So usually sometimes it also happens that there is a two-tier. In two-tier, what happens is either I have a web and the DB layer or the app and the DB layer. That's it. I have only the two layers. The database remains constant. Either of the one web or the application level layer will be removed off. And usually remember what happens with this three-tier layer. Let's say when we talk about the database, it is usually not given access to anyone, right? From outside world, never anyone will be given access to go through. So they can access it only from the jump box or a bastion host, if you remember, right? So if we have completely put this into one of our VPC, so if I have to log in into this, usually we'll place the database in the private subnet, and in order to get into the private subnet and access this database, I'll have to first come to the public subnet, and from the public subnet I'll be able to access this, right? So here application layer is going to be a part of the public subnet where we may actually log in, or there would be some other bastion host from where we are going to log in into the DB server. And when we talk about the application layer, here the port 22 will be opened up for your application, and this will be opened up only for the developers, right? So who are working from office, only for them, for the developers, it will be open. So if they try to even work from home or somewhere else, it will not be opened up. Now web server, as we all know, it is going to be exposed to the complete public. So port 80 and port 443, both of them are required to be opened up so that the people from across the world will be able to connect to my servers. So this is how usually we design the three-tier architecture. So web servers will be exposed to the public, and the app server, which is acting like a middleware here, is just going to be opened up for the developers of my company from my company's office network itself. That is the CIDR block range of company. And then finally, we'll have the database layer, which is completely in the private subnet, and that will be accessible only from the jump box or the application server in this case. In terms of elasticity, there's one more thing that I would like to highlight in here about auto scaling. So in auto scaling, we have three different types. One is proactive cyclic scaling. Second is proactive event-based scaling. And third is auto scaling based on demand. So what we have learned is all about the auto scaling based on the demand. And the other two which we have remaining are proactive event-based scaling and proactive cyclic scaling. Now, what happens to the cyclic scaling? So let's say every day at 9 o'clock in the morning, you have a web server which is going to conduct a game for thousands of people, right? So at that point of time, you know that you would require a lot of infrastructure because a lot of people are going to get into a web server. So you would like to have extra systems during that specific 1 hour of time because your game is going to continue for, let's say, 15, 20 minutes. Right. So in this proactive cyclic scaling, what happens? I can put up a schedule of daily, weekly, monthly, or quarterly and say that every Monday or every Tuesday, my game is going to be started at 9 o'clock in the morning, and I'm expecting at least 5,000 of users who are going to come and connect through. Right. So I'm just trying to scale my system up so that it will be able to cater the number of users who are connected to my system. So with the proactive cyclic scaling, we are basically trying to scale up our systems every day at certain period of time. Now, proactive event-based scaling. Now, let's say you are an e-commerce website like a Flipkart, Amazon, or a Snapdeal. And let's say you are trying to launch a new product today evening at 8 o'clock, right? Like 12 o'clock, sometimes at 12 o'clock in the afternoon, we have this the sale of Redmi or some other mobiles, right? So there is an event specifically. It doesn't occur every day, but it may occur once in a while, right? So maybe once in 3 months, I might have a specific day on which I'm going to launch this product and make it available for the end users. So at that time, I can actually make use of this proactive event-based scaling. So scaling just when you're expecting a big surge of traffic requests due to the scheduled business event, like we are specifically like trying to launch a new product or we are trying to market up some new campaign as well. And finally, the third one, we all know, auto scaling based on demand. So whenever the demand is going to increase, my CPU utilization is going to increase, and then we are going to make a trigger, and then it is actually trying to scale up the system. So remember, there are three types of auto scaling. One is proactive cyclic scaling, second is proactive event-based scaling, and the third one is auto scaling based on the demand. So that was all about the architecting practices, architecting with the best practices on the cloud. So any questions or queries from any one of you here? So we have a couple of more topics remaining in our section of the AWS here. So one of them is about the ALB and the NLB. For ALB, of course, I would like to give you a short introduction first. So what is ALB? ALB basically stands for the Application Load Balancer. And then we have a newly introduced something called as NLB. So NLB basically stands for the Network Load Balancer, right? So now, what is the major difference between both of them? So let's go down to the load balancers. Let's click on the create load balancer, and then you will be able to see that there are three different types, right? We have application load balancer, network load balancer, and the classic load balancer. Now, if you remember, when the Amazon first started providing the services in the cloud, it just started as one of the load balancer, and there you also had got HTTP, HTTPS, and the TCP connections, right? So we were able to use this classic load balancer for any of the type of layer we want to put across to. But when we come now, what Amazon has done is it has specifically divided the layers of the traffic. So if I am trying to put it on HTTP and HTTPS, specifically we are going to use the application load balancer, and if you want to use it for the TCP requests, we are going to put it behind the network load balancers. So specifically they have divided both of them. So usually I'm not sure if you guys have really known about this specific point. Like, there are seven layers of operating system, or the typical engagement that we call it as. So at the layer seven, is a place where specifically we host the applications, and the layer four is a place where the interchange happens. Right? So application load balancer completely works on the layer seven, and the network load balancer completely works on the layer four. So that is the first major difference on where they work. Second is, in this you have only got HTTP and HTTPS. In this we have got the TCP connections as well. Now there are a few more advantages of using the application load balancer as well. So let me give you a very short introduction before we go out and conduct a practical session on the ALB. Okay, so typically whenever we are trying to design any of the architecture, what happens in this case? Like, let's say this is the load balancer. This is my server one, server two, and let's say server three. So I have three servers and I have a load balancer in front of it. So what I'm going to do is, typically I'm going to connect the load balancer with all three of them. And usually what happens, I would have a route 53 on top of this. And my end users would be specifically, whenever they hit the URL, they're actually hitting the route 53, and route 53 is trying to actually hit the load balancer endpoint, and this load balancer is trying to talk to my EC2 instances and distribute the load. That is a normal methodology that we have been following until now when we talk about the elastic load balancer. Now what happens in the application load balancer? So in the application load balancer, I can actually divide my requests in the multiple parts. Let's say if I want to host two, three different domains, like I have a flipkart.com, I have something like paytm.com, I have, let's say, like amazon.com, I have three of them. So what happens in the original case, I need to actually spin up three different elastic load balancers, and three of them will have a different route 53 domain pointing, right? And then I need to have the multiple servers as well. So in this case, I'm actually paying the money for three different load balancers. Can we do some magic here? Yes, application load balancer actually helps us to do some certain specific magic here. Now let's say this is actually one complete setup. Okay, so let's say we are trying to host two different servers. So we basically have got two So we have two different setups completely. Now with the application load balancer, what I can do actually is, so I will still have Just expand this diagram a little more. Okay, so I will have this for, let's say, Amazon. I'll have this for the Flipkart. Okay, so the people are still trying to navigate. Okay, so I have got two different servers. One is for the Flipkart, one is for the Amazon. Okay, so now what I'm trying to do here is I'm trying to go ahead also save the cost with the help of application load balancer, and I'm also showing what is going to happen with the ALB in this case, right? So with the ALB, what happens is I just need to have one of them here in this case. Now both the domains are going to point out to the same load balancer. So specifically, I just need to have one load balancer which is going to be running all 24/7. So I'm completely saving a lot of cost in this case here. Now, this load balancer is specifically this load balancer is specifically going to navigate the traffic. Now, how does it know whether the traffic is coming from Amazon or Flipkart? Right, so what we are going to do is inside this we have a configuration which is called as target groups. So here I am going to put across so this is the target group one, let's say this is the target group two. So I have got something called as target groups, and these target groups are the place where I'm going to register my instances. So I would say that I would like to register the instance one, instance two, and then the instance three, right? Similarly, I'm going to register, let's say, three instances here, instance one, instance two, and then the instance three. Okay, so I have got the three instances, one for the Flipkart domain, one for the Amazon domain. But in the normal case or the normal situation, what happens? The public actually comes down to the Route 53. Route 53 will redirect you to the load balancer, and the load balancer is trying to balance the load on each of these EC2 instances and also tries to check the health of each of the instances. Now, in my case here, when I'm trying to use the application load balancer, the multiple domains can be pointing to the same load balancer, and this load balancer has in turn got something called as target groups. Now what happens with the target groups? All the registered targets, wherever I want to conduct a health check, all that will be done with the help of this target groups itself. So I'm going to make use of this target groups, and then I'm going to register all the instances to the target groups. Right, and these target groups are in turn registered with the ALB. So now in the ALB, what I'm going to do is I'm going to define a rule which says whenever you find in the URL the name is Amazon, just try to navigate the traffic to the this set of target group, and this target group is going to have the multiple instances which is going to manage the traffic as well as the health, right? And here again, whenever I see the traffic coming from something called as Flipkart, like in the URL, the domain name is Flipkart. And what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to come here, read the rule, and come down here, and then I'll be able to check through. Let's see a very small part of a practical section here. If possible, in the today's part, I'll complete, or else we'll complete the next part. So I'll just go ahead and click on create the application load balancer here. So it's going to ask me for the name. So I'll say my first app LB. Then it's going to be internet facing. This is going to be with the type of address IPv4. Here it's going to ask me whether I'm going to use HTTP or HTTPS. I'll keep it for HTTP for now. Then it's going to ask me whether you're going to make use of all the availability zones. I'll say yes. And then if you have any tags, there's no difference in the way we spin up the normal load balancer or the application load balancer. I'll just show you how to create a target group and register to this ALB. So I'll just go ahead and say name my first ALB. Since you are trying to use the HTTP protocol, it is not going to ask me for any security settings. And next, at the step number three, I'm going to go ahead and put across a web server security group. And in step four, yes, here is the place where I'm going to register my targets, right? So target groups, sorry. So target groups, we can, at this point of time, we can add only one. So once the load balancer is launched, we can go ahead and add one more target group as well. So I'll just go ahead and say we do not have any target group. I'll just say create target group one. So I'll say target group one. This is also going to work on the HTTP protocol at the port 80. And the target is going to be EC2 instance. Protocol is HTTP. And we are going to check for the file with the name healthy.html. And in the advanced health settings, I'm just going to keep it everything simple. Interval, I'll just keep it as 10 seconds. Healthy threshold to be part of 3 seconds so that our health checks are connected much faster. So this page is as same as the way we do it in the Elastic Load Balancer. Only few things are different here. So it does ask me the name of the target group, if it is going to be a new one or if you already have an existing one, right? So if it is a new one, just give the name of the target group here. So I'm just going to give it as name as target group one, and rest of the things remain same. It is going to work on HTTP protocol at the port 80, and the target type is going to be my EC2 instance, and I'm going to check for the file with the name healthy.html is the HTTP protocol. And in the advanced health checkings, we are trying to just check out what is the healthy threshold, unhealthy threshold, and then the timeout and the interval. Okay, so I'm just going to go ahead and register the targets in this. So currently I do not have any EC2 instances, so I can leave this page blank and then say next review and then say create. Right, so what did we do in this case specifically at this point of time? I created the load balancer, we created one target group. So this specific setting is already done. Currently I do not have instances, so we have not registered it, but we have created the setup of one target group. Now let's see how I can add a second target group to this load balancer. So I'll go ahead and close this. So when you come down to the listeners, so here I'll go inside the view and edit rules. So currently I have mapped it to one target, so it's showing the target group one. So what I can always do is go to the plus sign and then click on symbol here. Okay, so I'm still able to see the only one target group. So let's go ahead and add the second target group first here. So I'm going to go ahead and create one. So I'll come to the target groups, click on create target group. So I'll say so again, this is going to work on the HTTP protocol at the port 80, and then this is going to be part of the EC2 on the target type, we could do the instance, and this is going to be part of the default VPC. Health check will be done at the HTTP protocol, and the file we are going to check is for the healthy.html. And in the advanced health, we are going to set up the healthy threshold to be part of 3. Unhealthy to be 2, timeout 5, and interval to be 30, and then say, let's say, go ahead and say create. So we are going to close this. So there we go. Now we have two different target groups. So in the target group one, we are going to add the instances which are going to be of Flipkart. So how do we add the targets? You can simply come down to the specific portion and then click on edit, and then you can say which EC2 instances to be added. So let's say I have what 5 EC2 instances. Two of them are for Flipkart, 3 of them are for the Amazon.com, right? So from here, I can see which of them are for Amazon. I'll add them to the target group two and target group one, and then the other ones I'll add it to the target group one. So I have now got two target groups. Let's go back to our load balancer in this section now. Again, I'm back to the listeners. Here, when I'm going to click on the view edit rules, So it does ask me what kind of rule would you like to set across. So I can say that here. So it says host header or the path pattern. So I'm going to use the host header. So if I'm saying that if you find anything in the host related to Amazon, right? So I'm telling it to go ahead and forward the request to the target group 2. And if there is anything else, you can forward it to the target group 1. Simple. So, or you can add one more rule as well. Yeah, so here if you see, now if the host is going to contain the name with the Flipkart, then it's going to go to target group 1. If the host is going to conduct with the name Amazon, then it's going to target group 2. So by default, if anything it doesn't understand where to go, it will automatically go to the target group 1. Like now by default would be something like this. Let's say I'm trying to copy up this load balancer name, that is load balancer DNS name, and if I try to go ahead and hit it, then it doesn't understand whether the request is coming from the Amazon or the Flipkart, because still we have not mapped the route 53, right? So in that case, it is going to send all the things to the target group 1. So it says the default forwarding is to the target group 1. However, if you go ahead and check out inside, it clearly says that if the host is being flipkart.com, you will be always targeted to the target group 1. And if the host is going to be Amazon, you are going to send across all the traffic to the target group 2. So now if you go back to our diagram and check it out, so we have now actually created two different target groups. We have registered both the target groups with the load balancer, and this load balancer is now going to receive the traffic from the multiple Route 53 domains, right? So with the ALB, we can actually save a lot of cost in the company. So let's say where I have to run around more than 40 plus servers, let's say. Usually sometimes it does happen that when we are working in a company, they may have the internal applications. Like I have one application for the payroll, one application for the leave request, one application only for the HR policies. So I might have multiple applications in a single organization. So keeping a load ELB for each and every application is really costlier for me. So what I can do, in fact, I can actually make use of the ALB where I can set across the target groups and the traffic can be specifically diverted with the help of any rule that we are going to implement through. So any questions here on the understanding of the ALB, Rahul, Divya? How about you, Divya? Are you able to understand through? Okay, so that was about the ALB, and what happens in the NLB is basically we are trying to, one second, I just come down to this one. Yeah, so I'll go back here and let's click on create load balancer and click on NLB. So now the way we again try to spin up a load balancer, it would be more or less same. So I'll just give it as my first NLB, that is network load balancer. Again, this is going to be the internet facing, but here the only change would be I'm going to have only the TCP protocol. Remember, the ELB has got both TCP as well as HTTP and HTTPS, but network load balancer has got only TCP because it operates completely at the layer 4, it is a TCP layer, and the application load balancer is completely operating at the layer 7, that is with the HTTP and the HTTPS protocols. And again, I'm going to keep it in the default VPC with both the availability zones included, and I'll say next, configure the routing. So again, in this case also, we are going to have the targets, but you also, so I'll just go ahead and give it as a new target group. And then advanced health check again. We'll have this healthy and unhealthy threshold. So some of the things are hardcoded for us, we'll not be able to change through. So if you see the unhealthy threshold and the timeout, we'll not be able to make any changes. That is at 3 and the 10 itself. It's fine. And then we can go ahead and say click on the register targets. So currently we do not have any instances, so you can leave it off as this. So the way we are going to set up, there's no much change. So again, it is going to be as same as the application load balancers, but only thing is we are going to operate it at a layer 4 with only the TCP traffic, right? And in case of the application load balancer, we are trying to use it for the HTTP or the HTTPS traffic, right? Again, in this as well, let's check out what is the difference here. So again, I have the NLB. Okay, so here I'm not getting the option to put across the rules, so I'll not be able to put across any rules, but I'll be able to add multiple listeners in this case. So I can have one listener at port 80, one more listener at port some other, like I can have my HR application hosted on port 80, I can have my leave application hosted on port 8080. So all that things can be done across in this. However, we usually do not make use of it because it makes it much more complicated in this case. So we usually have one listener across it and we'll try to make use of these sections. So usually application load balancer is much preferred, where I actually can go ahead and configure the rules inside each of the listeners, saying that what will be the rule and what should happen whenever this is a kind of host that is coming in. And the most important difference is, remember, the layer 7 and the layer 4. So application load balancer usually works on the layer 7 and the network load balancer usually works on the layer 4. Yeah, so a few more things to remember. At layer 7, people can put across the SQL injection scripts, right? At the layer 4, the people can actually put across the SQL injection scripts with the help of which they can actually attack your application or do some things, right? So usually at that's why we prefer to go with the ALB for any web-based application where you want to make a hosting. You go for the layer 7 so that people, in case if they want to inject any SQL scripts and try to hack in your server, the most of the things are terminated at the ALB level itself or the layer 7, and they'll not be able to send across any kind of hacking request inside the applications. But at the layer 4, which is at the TCP level, in this, we will be able to inject the SQL scripts because we are directly connected to the servers behind, and that is a little different in the way how the layer 4 and the layer 7 load balancers work. So we always have to take care where we are going to implement the NLBs, and we have to take care where we are going to put across the ALBs. So NLBs specifically, we are going to put across for the databases or somewhere else where I know that it is completely internal or completely on the backend side, as well, it is going to help me directly connect to my IP addresses behind the scene of my machines, which are not going to change over the period of life. So remember, the ALBs will always have, ALBs and NLBs usually have the target groups, and the target groups will have the targets registered. So your target is nothing but a EC2 instance, and we are going to specifically save a lot of amount of money in terms of using the ALBs and the NLBs when compared to using the ELBs, where I need to have a separate setup for each of the application.